And we're back. Mike Cernich, DangerPlay.com, Gorilla Mindset, the Halo Effect. Got a little Halo Effect going on, trying to look like a demigod today. Conspiracy theories galore about me. Conspiracy theories galore. The latest is that... Well, I'll give you the backstory. I filed a lawsuit. It isn't technically a lawsuit. It's called a motion to intervene to get records involving a pedophile, Jeffrey Epstein. People are now saying that I'm working for Epstein. This is how dumb. Either these people are paid shills or they're just really dumb. That's why I got to be real careful what I write about, because dumb people who are really dumb find me. It's just struggle with. But anyway, we're going to take your calls. Why? I don't know. Why not? I just got up. Well, I've been up for a while, but got some coffee going on. I was talking about Paris, reliving the Paris days. I lived in Paris for 3 months. Beautiful place. Beautiful place. I think I might go back. Might go to Paris for a month. Got your book. Got your friends to get your books. Good for you. Thank you. Yeah, I think I'm going to go back to Paris for a month. I miss it, even though it isn't what it used to be. All right, we're going to take some of your calls. Call, talk about whatever. 866-438-1487. That is 866-438-1487. Give me a call. How are women in Paris? Great question. Parisian women are not beautiful. That is what's interesting. The reputation that people who have never been there or lived are like, oh my God, Parisian women are beautiful. No, but they look amazing. They take care of themselves. You want me to hold her?
No, I'm going to try to get her to start peeing.
The hippie stuff. We're trying to train Syra to not need a diaper. She's only 3 months old. We'll see how it works. But Parisian girls have a style about them, a way about them, that what makes them far more beautiful than just the looks. In terms of raw looks, American women, there are more beautiful women in America than anywhere else. This whole idea that, oh my God, the most beautiful women are here, the most beautiful women in the world come to America. That's how I can tell so many people are never traveled, or they're liars, or they're whatever. The most beautiful women in the world come to America because America is the land of opportunity. So in Paris, the women are, they dress in Paris. Wouldn't you say that, Shauna? They're not necessarily that pretty, but the way they dress makes them look beautiful.
Yes. They're very put together.
You will never find more put together women, but the most beautiful women are in America. Get out of here, guys. I always laugh about that kind of stuff. The number is 866-438-1487. 866-438-1487. Well, no, the girls in Hungary were naturally prettier.
They weren't stylish.
But they weren't stylish. So that's a girl's perspective. Okay, if you ask a woman where are the most beautiful women, they're going to tell you Paris. Because they're more about how a woman's put together, the style, right? Whereas if you're a man, it's more about the raw sort of animal aesthetic. And the women in Hungary were much more beautiful than the women in Paris to a man. So right now, you know that background noise? Shauna is convinced that you can communicate the sound of a thing, and that's how she knows to use the bathroom. Syra, I don't know, man. I stay in my lane. That's one thing people who know me know that I do. I'm gonna do a very good job of doing is that. Shauna wants to read a book about the diaper. It's called The Diaperless Baby. And hey, man, she doesn't tell me how to run my operation. I'm not gonna tell her how to run her operation. Santa Ana, California, you're live. Well, okay, you hung up. I just took somebody's call. They hung up on me. By the way, be sure to hit the like button. We got to build up these likes on the YouTube. Build up them likes. All right, we got Fremont, California. How you doing?
I don't know if that's me. I think that's me.
That That is you. How are you?
Oh, I'm good. Sorry, I'm on the bus right now, but I wanted to call in yesterday, and I was also on the bus yesterday, but I'd like to talk it just now. Thank you. Okay, come on. But your comment about all the beautiful women come to the U.S., something interesting I had been told at one point was, like, especially in the 80s and 90s, people like who worked at embassies, they didn't want to give visas to, like, ugly people because they thought, like, you know, these people are representing our country. And they only gave visas to, like, you know, like, the most beautiful people or the smartest people. So I think that's another aspect of why most beautiful people come to the U.S. But that's actually not what I wanted to call. I wanted to call about, am I still blind?
Yeah, you're still live. Yep.
Okay. So I work in tech in, you know, the Bay Area, Silicon Valley, whatever. And probably the most depressing thing that I've come to realize, because I still work in security, right? The most depressing thing is just how nobody cares about this whole Vault 7 thing. And all of my coworkers are, like, super hackers. And, you know, they're the most qualified to have an opinion on, you know, on this whole thing that happened. And none of them care. I've tried to, like, bring up a conversation. I hope you can hear me because I'm, like, outside.
Yeah, why do you think they don't... Why do you think they don't care? So the caller is saying she's in California. She works in tech and cybersecurity. None of her colleagues care. Why do you think that is?
Okay, well, based on my... Because I've been working here for, like, almost a year now. And based on my experience, like, everyone's, like, super calm. So they're all, like... It's so weird because they're kind of, like, resistant, but they're also super sadists. So, like, I tried to bring it up with people, and they're like, oh, well, tell us something you didn't already know. Like, they just don't care.
Yeah, this is a real problem. I think, well, they would care if it were George W. Bush. If it were George W. Bush's CIA who had been caught doing this, they would care.
That's exactly,
Right. So it's mainly because if their team is doing it, then they don't really care. Most people don't have any actual principles. They only care about it when the other side is doing it. But I cared when Bush did it, and I care when Obama was doing it, and if Trump is doing it, I'll care about that too.
Right. And most people, especially in this area, in general, in the Bay Area, they just don't care.
But they care about mean tweets. That is the thing about Vault 7 that,
yes.
Right? Right. So, if I post a tweet calling somebody a fatso, they will care more about that than they'll care about their Samsung smart TV spying on people. That's the world we live in. Bizarre.
Yeah, I was expecting to, like, log into work, and usually we have, like, these threads on our emails, and I was expecting, like, a huge thread about this, and there was nothing. But we've had huge threads on, like, you know, what size teacher, you know, like, there's no female features. Teacher sizes, and those guys are like 100 replies long.
Yeah, maybe we need to tell people that Vault 7 is a misogynist movement, and then maybe people would actually care. And that's the broader issue, is that nobody cares about anything other than identity politics nowadays. It used to be that people had high-minded principle, they cared about...
I was just calling, because I live down the street from you.
No, no, that was in the somebody joined the call, so I don't. Yeah, that's really who knows, but yeah, it used to be. Hold on, I'm gonna mute you. It used to be people had high-minded principles. They cared about freedom, democracy. Now everything is about identity politics. So if Vault 7 showed a conspiracy against women, everybody would care. If it showed a conspiracy against transgender bathrooms, why do we care more about transgender bathrooms than we do about really important issues, right? Why is that the most important issue in the world. I don't know. Hi, we got a caller from Visalia, California.
Hello?
Hi.
Hey, Mike. When you're talking about beautiful women, I know Stephen Molyneux talks a lot about the family and how that works. I just graduated high school, and have you ever talked to a girl that doesn't have a dad?
Have I ever talked to a girl who doesn't have a father?
Yes, because...
Oh, no, it's very common.
Yes,
I mean, it's very common.
When people say the thing called daddy issues, quote-unquote, but it's a very... What's the word? You'll be out, and it's an actual thing, and you can just tell someone from...
Oh, no, it's very... Yeah.
That person doesn't have a dad.
No, it's very common. No, I mean... fatherless children, man and woman. Oh, it's very, very common. No, and even the women who had fathers, the fathers were so cucked by moms and they were so emasculated that even if there was a male figure around, he wasn't even. I've written about this extensively, where that if you're an older man, you can meet more women in your 30s than you ever could in college. Because women are so starved for some kind of masculine energy in their life that you can be, 35 as a man, and you'll more college girls will be attracted to you than when you were in college. It's a really, that's, of course, big issue.
Yeah, so I just wanted to tell you that.
Oh, okay. Well, thank you for the call. You graduated high school recently?
Yes, I just I'm a junior right now. I graduated high school early. I just graduated high school this week.
Oh, congrats. Are you going to go to college, or what's next for you?
I'm not sure right now. I might look into a trade school because I don't want to get a PhD in gender studies and then have $200,000 in student debt lying around.
Yeah, I don't think you... I usually advise people not to go to college unless somebody else is paying for it. So if you'd be paying for...
I had a cousin who went to Berkeley, probably spent about $200,000 on tuition, and they didn't have a job for 5 years afterwards and took a job that didn't require a degree.
Yeah, I was at Columbia last week, and this is how out of touch I had become. I was at Columbia last week visiting friends, and they had told me that the student loan package is $80,000. And I go, what are you talking about? Tuition alone is $50,000. Once you go in food, housing, books,
right. They're
borrowing $80,000 a year. And how is this not a criminal? How do you loan an 18-year-old $80,000? I don't even owe $80,000 to anybody. How in the world do you do that? It's a crime.
Yep.
It's a crime what we're doing to the young people. I can't believe it. Because my mind was so blown. I didn't even know what I like. I mentioned this last night. A lot of times I feel like I'm high every day because to contemplate the world we live in will blow your mind. $80,000, $80,000 a year, 4 years, that's $320,000. Plus, when you borrow the money, the $80,000, usually that interest is capitalizing on it. So you're graduating $350,000 a year. What in the world? How are you going to make that back? Even doctors I know doctors who owe $350,000, they can barely pay it back, and they're doctors. Unbelievable.
Yeah, that's exactly. I watched Stephen Molyneux's videos on how it's more for businesses. They would like someone they could pay less versus someone they would have to pay more that has $300,000 in debt.
Well, and plus now with HB1s, even if you have a degree, they would just they'll just bring in labor from other countries.
Exactly.
I think student loan issues, this is one complaint I have. Not complaint. I don't like the word complaint. One way Trump could improve his messaging is student loans are a big issue. Whoever gets ahead on this student loan issue is going to open up new pathways. I believe in a debt jubilee. Personally, and this is going to rile up people are going to go, but they borrowed the money, they signed the contract, as if an 18-year-old who's being told by every adult figure in his life, every teacher, every administrator, every parent, told by everybody, to do it. Well, they borrowed the money. They signed the contract. How about people who lied to the youth and have enslaved them? How about they take responsibility for saying, you know what, we gave you bad advice. You have no hope. Young people have no hope. That's the thing I learned when I walk around is, man, when I was, 22, 23, you know, if you guys think I'm on fire for the world now, I'm lazy. I'm lazy compared to where I used to be. When I was young, you're just like optimistic. Like, hell yeah, I can do anything. I can start. And I still feel that way. Don't get me wrong. At 39, I still feel fantastic every day. Incredible. I mean, you guys watch me. Doesn't look like I'm, you know, not worn out or anything. But when you're, there's just this enthusiasm and this idea that there's infinite possibility when you're young, but I didn't have all this debt. So what do you tell people?
Exactly. Well,
what do you tell people? They have to pay $1,000 a month in debt. Unbelievable.
It's ridiculous. And Stephon Molyneux, the stereotype that Republicans hate education because they don't want to subsidize schooling. It's ridiculous.
Yeah, I'm pro education. Nobody recommends more books than I do. If you read the books that I recommend, you'll have a better education than any PhD in the world, pretty much.
I know. It's the free market has always provided better goods than government.
Yeah. Well, thanks for your call. Best of luck to you.
Yep, thank you.
If you do go to college, go to community college. That's what I always tell people. Do 2 years of community college. That way you can get good grades, get a 4.0. This is what I did. I went to community college. 2 years. Why?
Because
I'm not a moron. Didn't want to graduate. I graduated college. No debt.
Yeah, if I had the choice, I'd probably want to go to Liberty University.
Well, go to community college for 2 years, get great grades, transition to the college life. You can get you can do it, it's like $50 a credit hour or something. Read the books that you want to read, learn what you want to learn, work part-time, live with five guys in an apartment, meet a lot of girls, have fun, don't get caught up, don't do anything dumb. Live life, man.
Exactly.
Community college for two. So it isn't college or no college, right? That's one thing that people on my team.
What...
Yeah, I went to community college for 2 years, and I had and I had no debt, and I lived at home.
Yeah.
That's another thing I think is stupid, that people are like, oh my God, people live with their parents. You should.
Exactly.
You should live with your parents until you're 21, 22.
Yeah.
And go to community college and save a bunch of money. And then I transferred to a four-year university. So rather than being 18, living in a dorm with a bunch of retards, getting drunk, people pounding on doors, morons fighting, people can't handle their alcohol, all these idiots, right? Who wants to be around drunk college idiots? You're 18.
I've
terrible.
Been a fair share of that in high school.
Yeah, exactly.
I was homeschooled most of until about 8th grade, and I still had to dodge all this stuff going through high school.
Yeah, that's what I mean, and it gets even worse. It's better to, you do 2 years, and 2 years community college, graduate, no debt. I graduated college with money in a Roth IRA, because I was in college, I would put away $100 every month into a Roth IRA, you know? It's another thing nobody teaches.
A summer job just to pay for his tuition, actually two summer jobs, while most people are just out vacationing, and while their debt is collecting interest.
Well, and the thing, too, that a lot of people like your dad still don't get, though. How old's your dad?
He's 53.
Yeah, people in the 50-year-old age bracket, they don't realize that isn't even possible anymore. You can't work a summer job and pay a full year of tuition because education has gone so far up. Now education, that's why...
Stephon Molyneux has said, if more...
Yeah, go ahead.
If more people are in education... more demand, the prices are going to shoot through the roof. And that's exactly what's happened.
Exactly. Thank you for your call, sir. You have a good day. You have a good life.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, this whole nonsense that we should not forgive the student loan debt of the children. I can't believe it. You know, I can't believe it. They've been lied to, ripped off, conned. They've been conned. You don't want young people without hope. This is what a lot of people don't understand. Because I understand humanity. Young women without hope don't have children. Right? People go, why is the birth rate low? Young women without hope don't have children. They also need men who are going places. Young men without hope do not become fathers. They don't have any enthusiasm for life, and then they become terrorists. If we want terrorism in America, we need to worry less about Islam, although that is an issue. We need to worry about student loan debt. What do you tell a kid, no hope? What do you tell a kid, $200,000 in debt, hey bro, you're never gonna pay this back. You're never gonna pay it back. So Lisa's saying, teach your kids personal responsibility. The whole system. What about personal responsibility for people who gave $200,000 to an 18-year-old kid? Raise your hand. Would anybody here give $200,000 to a teenager and expect them to pay that back? I wouldn't. I wouldn't give you 50 bucks, you know? Maybe if you do work. Wouldn't expect it. Why then do we magically, this is what I call the negative magical thinking. None of us are going to loan money to a kid. If a kid goes, hey, I got a business idea, right? Imagine this. 18-year-old comes up to you. I got a business idea. I need $250,000. You'd laugh, right? You'd be like, are you out of your mind? Do you want $250,000? Well, that's all an education is, a business idea. You wouldn't give it to them. But then we magically wrap it up into student loans and personal responsibility, blah, blah, blah. That happens all the time in Silicon Valley. Well, it actually goes to a company. It doesn't go to the kid. Thank you. I always love when people think they know what's going on all the time. Nobody gives a kid $250,000. It also doesn't happen all the time. Well, how many come on, I live there. Too many people learn about the world on the internet, not the real world. All right, we got, here, who we got? Santa Ana, California.
Hey, Mike, it's Nestor.
Nestor, I'm doing great. How are you?
Good. Sorry I hung up on you. I had a customer come in.
Okay, good. Well, customers come first.
I just wanted to do a quick comment on the guy that called in. Mm-hmm. He wanted to go to a trade school, and I think it's a really good idea. But on top of what you said, community colleges have really good trade school programs for automotive, for welding, for whatever it is. So if he does want to think about going to a trade school, community college is a good avenue for trade school because they're way cheaper. When I went to trade school, I spent around like $35,000 for automotive, but I wish I would have gone to a community college.
Oh, wow. Okay, so hold on.
My trade school.
So for those,
I also would have gone to college experience.
So for those of you who don't know, that's my friend Nestor. He's a successful businessman, young entrepreneur. He has a good YouTube page also, Nestor the Mechanic. What's your YouTube page called?
The Mechanic OC.
The Mechanic OC. So what he's telling you is that maybe it isn't the best idea to go to a trade school. Maybe you should actually learn those same trades at a community college. Is that what you're saying?
Exactly. Because it's way cheaper, and you also get that college experience. And if you don't like the trade, you could still do something else in the community college. The community colleges are really underrated, and a lot of people don't know the great benefit they have. I mean, the community college over here, called Saddleback, they have amazing trade school programs. On top of that, they do have really good courses that you could use to transfer into a UC if you want to. But like you said, community college is a big underrated thing that nobody really talks about.
Okay, well, but now, see, my own callers educate me. You can go to a community college and learn a trade. Right? Talk about the red pill. You've all just been red pilled. You can now tell all the youth the real red pill. So you don't have to go to Berkeley or trade school. You could go to community college and learn a trade. And I think community college, what is it, like $80 a credit hour or something like that? Last time I looked, it was unbelievably. Yeah. Like Santa Monica, when I lived in Santa Monica, I was going to take a web design class, and it was $80 a credit hour. I was like, wait a minute. I did the math. I go, $80 a credit hour, so you can go to college for 12 hours, 12 credit hours a semester for less than $1,000. You could go for 3 years, work, save money, and live a good life and still, meet women and have fun and go to the gym and do all that kind of stuff that I like to do. You know, I'm not going to pretend like when I was, you know, when I was in community college, I was also going to the gym, having fun, you know, doing things, working hard, making money and everything. Unbelievable.
Yeah, it's, I mean, community college for automotive, I did the math, and a lot of guys are spending about right around under 10 grand, and a lot of it gets paid for if you get, you know, help from the government, which you do. A lot of guys get help, so because I get questions all the time from younger guys on my YouTube channel saying, "Nestor, what do you think I should do? Should I go to UTI, which is a main trade school for automotive?" And I go, "Look, community college where it's at, you're going to save a lot of money, and you're going to have a good career. And if you don't like it, you're not going to spend a lot of money, you know, figuring that out, unlike going to Berkeley for $200K, and you don't even have the job and your degree." So,
would you write a guest article about this for dangerandplay.com?
Yeah, I'd love to.
Okay, so let's call it trade school versus community college, and make the point that you can learn a trade at a community college, because I didn't even know this, and I know a lot. So this is something I didn't even know. So I think this will definitely be good for my audience, especially the younger men who read. So if you want to write that up for me,
we'll post it. Yeah, of course. I'll do that, and I'll send it over.
All right. Thanks, Nestor.
Of course, buddy. Take care. Bye.
See, even I learn from my callers. Learn something new every day. How you doing, Santa Cruz, California?
It's me.
It's you.
Before I was going to go into a chiropractic appointment. Hey, Mike, I called a couple days ago, but it was about how to contact you, and you said that I sent you a DM, and I did that. I just wanted to remind you of that, but also I got to get into this appointment, but I wanted to say just a suggestion. If you can, I don't know if you can do this, but Periscope before you do a live YouTube, because the emails are way delayed, and that's why I came late here for this live call, but I get the Periscope immediately, and so that would trigger me to come and check out the YouTube. Just a suggestion.
Great idea. I appreciate it. Thank you, sir. Good luck with your appointment.
All right. Thanks, man.
Yeah, Periscope. It's a good tip. Florida, how you doing?
Hello?
Hello.
Oh, I'm sorry. I wasn't sure whether or not it was my turn.
You're live. Mike Cernovich, dangerplay.com, Gorilla Mindset.
Yes. Can you hear me? Is it Mike?
It is.
Okay. I was listening to your show. I heard a lot of really good stuff. Was the topic today about the Vault 7 leaks?
No, we're just... I'm having my first coffee of the day, and we're just hanging out, man. Just the bros and bros and the girls hanging out in my, you know, whatever you call this, lounge, my den.
Okay, excellent. I like to make a few comments about the Vault 7 leaks. I think it's really great that more people are finding out that basically there's a lot of subversive activity going on within our intelligence agencies, which is scary. I think that it's our intelligence agencies have been used as a tool by the globalists to basically domesticate, you know, the American people. I also thought the education that you guys were talking about was really important. I think a big problem in America is that we don't really get, you know, a good education. I think we learn a lot of stuff that isn't really that useful, like you're an entrepreneur yourself. I mean, they teach us how to work for somebody, not to get up, go out and start businesses. And I think that if they did more of that, that'd be a great thing. Also, I think I wish somebody told me when I was younger, go to trade school, put in 2 years, and then you can jump into the workforce to make like $40,000 a year. I think that would have been a much better thing to do than just to go straight into like a bachelor's program or a master's program. So a lot of the topics you guys talked about are really, really helpful, especially for the younger crowd.
Yeah, man, look, here's the thing. The whole world is messed up. I am 39. My job is now an author, journalist, filmmaker, whatever, right? Before that,
right.
I was a lawyer. Before that, I did, you know, waited tables, odd jobs, worked at, you know, a hardware store. Why do you take an 18-year-old and just say, oh, what do you do for the rest of your life? Borrow $200,000 and make a decision on what you're going to do for the rest of your life. In what world? Right? The average person changes jobs now 10 times. They change careers 3 times. In what world do you say, you're 18, pick a major, here, sign the dotted line, borrow $80,000 a year, and what? It's completely ludicrous. That's why I said I feel like I'm high every day. That is so dumb. Here's what I tell the kids that call me. I go, why don't you go wait tables for a year, make some pocket change, get an apartment, live with 4 or 5 other guys, learn what that is like, save your money, go to Thailand for a month or two. College is going to be there. It isn't college. If you turn 18, 19, 20, 21, college doesn't disappear. It isn't like, oh no, I can never go to college now because I didn't go when I was 18 and that's precluded from me. We're destroying our young. It frustrates me to no end with the baby boomers, the advice the baby boomers have given to the young people. It tells me that they've never actually kept up with what is going on and completely out of touch. And there's going to be a youth revolution. There's going to be a youth revolution.
I agree. You know what? I think it's really interesting you made that point that a lot of this, like what the advice the baby boomers give people, I think you're right, because if you look at the people that decide what the curriculum should be, there's actually like a specific field, I forgot the name of it, but they basically decide, okay, well, if you're going to study biology, you need to learn this. If you're going to study architecture, you need to learn this. I have a feeling that all those people that decide what the entire nation should be learning for their respective fields have never actually owned a business, done anything on their own. They basically worked for the government in some capacity. I can guarantee people like you that have done multiple things, that have, you know, been successful, proven yourself, you know, in different ways, would be much better to decide these types of things. You know what I mean? Like, I don't know how to explain that, but it's just, there's a lot of unnecessary. I had a friend that just graduated with an engineering degree, and I've been interested in engineering, and I was outside building a plane, actually, one day, and he came out. He's like, yeah, you know, I'm about to graduate with my engineering degree, but all the firms that I apply to, they all want to see that I know all these computer programs, and like, we do all this, you know, really calculus and all like this really technical stuff, but the actual programs that you will use to, you know, make circuit boards or to like do different engineering things, they don't even teach them that. And that's like the first thing that the companies want to know that you have. So it's, to me, it's just like, because it's a business, I think the more classes you take, the more money they make. It's just really, it seems very inefficient.
That's a good line. The more classes you take, the more money they make. You should. If that is not trademarked already, then you should trademark that. The more classes you take, the more money they make.
I appreciate it.
All right, thanks for the call, my friend.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. All right, take care. Bye.
The youth. By the way, hit the like button. Let's get me up to 200 likes. We got to build up this YouTube. Periscope has already been, you know, they delisted me. So if you search for me on Periscope, you can't find it. So I got to build up the YouTube, build up the blogs, build up the books. But it really is amazing what we're doing to the young. And nobody talks about this. Here's what I hate. Everybody want, you know, all these old people, they put the hair plugs, they color their hair. They want to look young. Oh, I'm so cool, right? They're not cool. They're not fooling anybody. Who is talking about the young? Who? Not even Bernie. Bernie cried about education, free. Who's talking about the young? The issues facing young people. The student loan debt slavery. 1 in 4 women on antidepressants. Men who have no purpose, no life vision. Who's talking about the youth? And what we can do for the young in America. How we can give them opportunity. How we can get them engaged in who? Tell me, who other than me and my friends who get made fun of, right? I love that. I love how people try to make fun of me for providing guidance to young people, especially young men. Oh, I'm such a bad guy. I'm such a bad guy because I teach men, especially young men, a lot of life skills that they never learned. Oh, yeah, you're right. Oh, What is anybody doing? I think about that a lot of times. What the hell is anybody doing? The only thing that the media establishment is teaching people is how to complain. How to complain and to view yourself as a victim. This is the only thing you're going to learn from the generation. Here's all you're going to learn from people above you. Borrow a bunch of money. Oh, and you have to pay it back because you signed the contract. Take responsibility. Oh, but we're not going to take responsibility for lending you the money. You know that student loan debt is the only kind of debt where they can do that. You can't plead bankruptcy. So if I loan you, if you come to me with the business idea and I loan you money and the business fails, I'm on the hook. I lose that money. You can plead bankruptcy. With education, you can't file for bankruptcy. You are trapped. You are trapped, okay? The only thing that you learn if you're a young person is how to view yourself as a victim. Sounds like a conspiracy of mind control to me. They don't teach you self-reliance. They don't teach you thrift. I mean, think about this. Think about this. Where's the message of thrift? Do you know what kind of car I drive? I finally bought a new car. I can buy any car, not to brag. But I can go buy any car that I want to buy right now, and I could just buy it. Do you know what I bought? I bought a cool car, but I bought it used. I didn't buy it new. I would never buy a new car. Why is this the government's job? Because we're stuck here together. This is something that the right, especially conservatives, kind of overlook is it shouldn't be the government's job. It shouldn't be the media's job. It should be the parents' job. Parents have failed. We're stuck here together. This is the whole point. This is why this is my issue with the white nationalists and everybody. Is I don't get offended or triggered that people are white ethno-nationalists. I don't get triggered by it. But we live in America. We're stuck in here together. That's my line is we are all trapped in here together. So you have kids with no hope. You have women with no hope. You have men who are aimless, purposeless. You have negative messaging from the media. You have debt slavery for people. You have a consumption mindset taught to people. It shouldn't be the government's job. It shouldn't be. What are you going to do though? Right? My life is always about mindset. This is the world that we live in. Here's the world that we live in. This is the world we live in. How can we improve the world we live in rather than say it's not my job? It is our job. Am I my brother's keeper? What happened to that biblical sense of, hey, I should look out for other people, right? That's what I do. I'm looking out for you. Look out for people. You never get bad advice from me. That's what people admit. You're never going to get bad advice from Mike Cernovich. You're always going to get good advice from me because it is my personal responsibility to make the world a better place. Why? Because we're stuck in here together. I would love to live in a utopia. Live in a utopia where the only people around me are utopian people. That's not the world we live in. We live in the real world. So anyway, where's the message of thrift? So I got a new car. All right, got a new car. So 2015. Why is it a 2015? Because it ain't what you make, it's what you keep. I could go to the dealer, any dealer, buy a brand new Ferrari. I could just say, I want that Ferrari. I would never do that though. Why? Thrift. It's not what you make, it's what you keep. We're not teaching this to the young. We're not teaching young people, hey, if you can only save $10 a month, save $10 a month. That's what I teach in Guerrilla Mindset. If you can only save a few dollars a month, only save a few dollars a month, but save it. Get in that thrift mindset. This is a problem. Now, maybe, you know, is it the government's job to do it? Hey, here we are. That's the way I look at it is. That's what I look at it is. It isn't time to wonder whose job is what. We live in a historical time. It's our job to look out for each other. North Carolina, how you doing? We got a caller. You got a North Carolina area code. And 5, 4, 3, 2. All right, we tried. Rhode Island, how you doing?
How you doing, Mike?
Doing great, man.
Relatively new to listening to you. It was, you know, the Pizzagate thing started unfolding, and I was just looking for more information and stumbled onto you. I have a particular question about something I've seen sort of recently that I wanted you to address. It relates to you and Alan Dershowitz.
The conspiracy theory.
That it's total disinfo stuff.
Yeah, the conspiracy theory going around me. I literally... This is what's great. This is what happens when there are paid shills in the movement. So I literally am trying to get court documents involving Jeffrey Epstein. Right. People are now saying I work for Alan Dershowitz because Alan Dershowitz is in my movie. But hold on. This is how nutty these people are. So hold on a second. For those of you watching, I'm going to grab something. If I can find it. Come on. Where are you at? Where are you at? So this is how the shills work. People go, Mike Cernovich is working for Alan Dershowitz. Why? Because Alan Dershowitz was in my movie, Silenced. You want to know who else was in my movie, Silenced? You see that?
Hey.
Scott Adams, James Altucher, Andrew Arnheimer, a.k.a. Weave, Father John Baukos, Scott Barrows, Alum Bakari, Paul Boteen, Rick Bradbury, Adonis Bravo, Mike Cernovich, bless me, Melissa Chin, Anthony Cumia, and then Alan Dershowitz, Pax Dickinson. So they're saying that because I have a guy in a movie, then somehow I have some kind of weird relationship with it. So yeah, my response to all that is there are a lot of shills in the movement trying to discredit me because I'm a powerful voice in the movement and I'm actually doing good. And I have no time for those conspiracy theories. Thank you for your call.
No, totally. Can I add one more thing?
Go ahead.
I didn't mean to bring it up in terms of I'm actually questioning. It seemed pretty clear from reading the various articles I've seen that it's definitely shill stuff. But yeah, I just want to add that it seems like a lot of the standard tactics that are used in counter-intel or psyop in psychological warfare are really not taking hold because people seem to be really astute, really on their game. But the one thing that does seem to be getting a little more traction than some of the other tactics I've seen in the past used is this effort to sort of discredit and create dissension because I feel like people have this black and white sense that it's either people are all the way against or people are sort of complicit and for this bigger thing that's going on. It's not, though. I mean, I don't think it's black and white like that. Everyone just has their own personality. And it seems like that's the biggest area where people are getting divisive is, you know, someone doesn't like a personality, so then they're more liable to buy into some type of ad hominem attack or shill attack. And then that creates that dissension and that creates that separation, which everyone's trying to fight against.
Yeah,
so that's everything you do, Mike.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, I've literally spent $15,000 to try to get records about Jacine Maxwell and Jeff Epstein. And then it now has become that I'm doing it for... how does this work? How does it work where I try to get court records involving Jeffrey Epstein? Jeffrey Epstein files a motion to quash my motion. In other words, trying to tell the judge, don't even listen to that guy. Don't even listen to his motion. But then somehow I'm working for him. That's what I mean. Either of these... And what a lot of people don't realize is that people like me are powerful. Because we reach a big audience. Most of the hate about me is actually not real people. That's why they're paid. They're paid to hate on me. Because anybody who's big and is looking into this pedophilia stuff, they want to immediately discredit me. Because if they get rid of me, you got a few random people on vote.co talking about pedophiles. Right? You got, in the threads, maybe you get 80 views. When I talk about things, it becomes a national conversation, right? Millions of people read about it. Millions of people learn about it. So that's why these people, they want to go after me, to discredit me. And I know the good people are on my side. But it gets a little frustrating when I paid $15,000 to try to, and it's going to cost me 20 grand total at least. I can do a lot with 15, 20 grand, you know, other than litigation. Right? Litigation, all this money on litigation against Jeff Epstein, and now people are saying that because Alan Dershowitz, there's a picture of me with Alan Dershowitz. No kidding. There's also a picture of me with Kurt Metzger, Candace Owens, Jason Pott. Well, I don't have a Jason Pott, and I didn't interview him. But with Milo, Ricky Vaughn. Ricky Vaughn's in my film. Am I working for Ricky Vaughn because he's in my movie? So that's what they do. They take in, I don't even know where Alan Dershowitz is. Find Alan Dershowitz in here. Find Alan Dershowitz in here. All these people are in my movie. So what they did, like shills, like complete and total frauds. All these people are in my film. Thank you, Rob. Rob, you've been a big help, actually. Huge help. All these people are in my film. So what they do is they don't say, hey, look, Mike has pictures of him with almost everybody in his film. What they do is they go, oh, Al, here's a picture of Mike with Alan Dershowitz. He must be a secret operative of Alan Dershowitz. So dishonest. And that tells you, if anybody says I work for Alan Dershowitz, well, first of all, Alan Dershowitz is a hero lawyer. Everybody knows about him, right? Every lawyer knows who Alan Dershowitz is. It's unbelievable. So it seems weird to people maybe don't know who Alan Dershowitz is. Every lawyer knows about him. But you can also, I went to Pax Dickinson's home right there. Pax. Went to his own home in Pennsylvania. Beautiful place we shot. Gorgeous footage of Pax Dickinson's home. Miriam Sadiq, Muslim feminist. She's in the film. Oh, am I really working for Islam? Am I a secret covert Muslim agent because I had a Muslim in my film? Right? That's the kind of stuff shills do. They really lie. By the way, be sure to watch Silenced, Our War on Free Speech. It's only on Vimeo. Only on Vimeo right now. Have a good day, sir. North Carolina, how you doing?
Hey, Mike. I'm good. How are you, man?
Doing well, dude.
So, you had a weed brought up yesterday, and, like, to be honest with you, I think weed opens a lot of minds, because I started when I was 15. I've been doing it for 10 years, but the only reason I know anything I know now is because I started and learned how the government, you know, got rid of weed, so it open the door to all the other lies that, you know, that are perpetrated by the establishment, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And also, have you ever read Andrew Breitbart's Righteous Indignation?
Yep, great book.
Yeah, like, I just listened to that book recently, and it really synthesized, like, everything, like, it's so true. Everything is connected. History is just, like, mind-blowing. Like, I just have this unsatiable craving for knowledge, and I just can't stop, you know, searching for the truth. Like, I'm an ANCAP myself, but, like, I realize this whole Trump movement is, like, we just have to build bridges and connect, and, like, I started my own Twitter. Like, I messaged, I'm AncapAnt91. DM'd you the other day. Like, I've been following Stefan for like 3 years. Like, it's just, we just gotta spread that knowledge.
All right, thank you for the call.
Thanks, Mike.
Yeah, so there's a lot of people, big believers in weed. You know what? I don't hate on weed. I don't personally smoke it. Actually, I've never hated on weed. The thing I've said about marijuana is that it isn't my drug of choice, because I like to be more alert, more focused. My drug of choice is always going to be nootropics, modafinil, things to make me more hyped, on point. But hey, we all have our things. And if you're not hurting anybody else, that's always been my perspective. Personal freedom for everybody. Smithtown, New York, how you doing?
Hi, Mike. Thank you for taking my call.
My pleasure.
I just want to say I met you a couple of times in person, and you're very welcoming and so positive to be around you and in your presence, especially in person. Couple of things. I was motivated to build my platform. I've been working on that as well. I'm a little nervous right now. My son's a high school senior, and a mandatory meeting this year, I found out, was Guerrilla Mindset. So I thought that was awesome, and you just might like to know that.
Thank you, yeah.
At his school. And I want to just talk about Trump. I feel like he's surrounded by GOP assassins, especially with as it pertains to the health care, the repeal and replacement of Obamacare. I really think they should have had that, 8 years to set that up a little better.
It's disgrace, right? What a disgrace. This Paul Ryan health care monstrosity. What a joke. What a joke, right? I can't support that. How does it help America? What the hell is it? Right? Unbelievable. They had, like you said, they had 8 years. But 8 years, that's the best they could do. I could come up with better than that in 8 days. This is why I hate Republicans. I'm not a conservative. I'm only a Republican because Trump is. And because we're taking over the Republican Party. I hate these people. I despise them. They're incompetent or corrupt. I don't know what it is, but that's why I've always told people, don't call me a conservative. I'm not a conservative. Whatever these Paul Ryan people are, whatever these conservatives are, I got nothing to do with that.
It's funny, over the years, how my views have changed. You know, I was a libertarian, then I was more conservative, and now I got to admit, I find myself being more of a libertarian than anything else. But, I really believe that Trump deserves our support, and we should do everything we possibly can to rid the GOP of the cucks and have Trump truly take over the party and push his agenda through that to help make America great again.
Yeah, I'm a closed border libertarian. So I recognize that if you want to have libertarianism in America, you cannot have open borders, because if you import people who aren't libertarians because of the way our democratic system works, they are going to vote for anti-libertarian policies. To me, this is so, like, why is nobody talking about this? Why has nobody ever said what I just said? I'm a closed border libertarian. Why does nobody talk about it? I don't know. Because you can't have freedom if you import people who are anti-free, because the way our democratic system works, they can vote in, they can outvote the libertarians. Which is another reason I don't call myself libertarian. I mean, libertarianism is that morbidly obese guy was wearing a G-string walking around on stage looking disgusting, right? That's what people think of as libertarianism. Or that weirdo Gary Johnson or whatever. He humiliated libertarians. He was such a bad libertarian. He was such an embarrassment that I think that maybe he was a CIA operative used to discredit freedom and libertarianism. There's no other explanation for that. What a complete buffoon that guy was. Probably CIA.
So true. All right. Great show, Mike. Thank you for calling.
You have a good day. Cool.
Thank you so much for what you're doing for the country, representing us all.
Thank you. We're on it. New Jersey, did I already take your call or not? I don't remember.
Oh, no, you didn't take me yet, Mike.
You're the last caller. Welcome. Last but not least, we have a caller from New Jersey.
But you've taken me before. This is very fake news on Twitter. And, we talked about the other day about not giving the press any credibility. And look what happened right after that. We were down in the dumps about Sessions recusing himself. And all of a sudden, Trump strikes back with the humor. Hey, maybe we should investigate Pelosi. Mm-hmm. And boom, then he comes out with the accusation against Obama. Boom, we're controlling the news cycle again. It's just that simple.
Exactly.
I mean, if you're a football coach, and every time you call a run up the middle, it gains 50 yards, keep calling the run up the middle.
Hey, man.
Right. He needs to tweet 15, 20 times a day and control the news cycle. They won't be able to talk about their Russian fantasies.
So I told him, Trump needs to be 10, 20 times a day on Twitter. And I did a whole video, I did a whole call-in show on how pathetic the social media team on Trump's is. They should be 10 times a day hammering the message, hammering the narrative. Every article that Trump pumps out could get millions of views. Keep the media on the back leg. 100% agree, sir. I'm glad that you understand. And make sure you let these people know on Twitter, Trump needs to tweet more.
And, Scott Adams, to top off on that, I actually asked Scott Adams, I said, Trump is like Charlie Brown holding the football, and the press is loose. He keeps trying to kick it, and Trump keeps pulling the football away. And why does the press keep falling for it? And he had a great answer. He said they have no choice. Whatever he says is news.
Exactly.
So there you go. just keep hammering it, and they have to cover what you say. Don't give them any time to talk about their agenda. We want to talk about our agenda.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Few people understand it. Great call. Thank you for the call.
Okay. Thanks, Mike.
Have a good day.
Bye.
Great batch of callers, as per usual. Great batch of callers. Thanks for tuning in. I might do a whole stream on social media again. I don't know. Before you go, hit the like button. Let's get this to a bunch of likes. We're building up the YouTube because Periscope has just been messing with my account. So hit the like button. And if you haven't already, make sure you subscribe. Subscribe to it. That way you always find out when we're going live. And I'm doing, I did a right side video yesterday. So I'm doing a video a day. Thanks, Lisa. Oh, we got a few trolls in here. Let's get them out of here. What do you think about kids playing sports and not working? We'll do another one. But anyway, be sure to like this. Be sure to subscribe. I'm doing a video every day. Yesterday I did a video with Right Side Broadcasting. So if you're not watching The Right Mindset, that show has been good. It's similar to this, call in, but we're a little bit more newsy. So hit the like button, hit the subscribe button. Thanks for tuning in. Mike Sermon, StageOfPlay.com, Gorilla Mindset.